Hi all, welcome to Trek Trav. I am Trav, this is Ribbit. He's looking particularly warm. I am wearing his jacket, and we're talking about Star Trek Voyager season 1 episode 5, The Phage.
We went sugar free.
In this episode, we find out that Voyager is running low on dilithium. Apparently, they're already ration packs. I wish it looked a little bit more dilapidated and like they were struggling.
Well, you know what? It's been a rough time for them because they've got to survive off Neelix's fucking cooking.
Well, yes. Neelix has decided that the captain's personal dining room is now his kitchen. Which is fine, but I feel like you would have noticed the connection of gas, food being moved. I feel like, does she not eat meals?
I don't think she pays attention to a lot of things.
I feel like that's kind of important. If it's her personal dining room and she seems so annoyed.
No, I feel like if it's her personal shit she doesn't give a shit about, but she cares about the rest of the crew more.
Then Janeway and that discover a planet which has dilithium on it, or they believe dilithium on it. They head to that planet. Neelix has been studying his away team manual and he wants to go along on the mission.
He suggested to go to the planet as well.
Yeah, did he suggest to go to the...
Yeah. So he suggested to go to the planet because it has a massive dilithium thing and it's like the biggest thing ever.
It was a rumor though, wasn't it? It was just a rumor.
It's a rumor, yeah.
So it's Neelix's fault what happens in the rest of the episode.
Which is fitting.
Sounds like Neelix. They beam down to the planet, there's lots of caves, but no signs of dilithium. If you don't know what dilithium is, it's a crystal that goes into the warp drive, which helps to inject antimatter into the core, or it is the power source. It's never fully defined, but it's very important.
It's a rock.
Yeah, so Tuvok, Chakotay, and Neelix split up and go looking through the cave. They don't find anything. No dilithium at all. The caves are obviously stage 9, which is where they film all the stuff. Neelix is wandering around and picks up a life sign. And Chakotay's like, get the fuck back.
Yeah, I don't know if he picked up a life sign or if it was just like some weird readings.
I feel like that if you're on your first away mission after convincing the captain you're on an away mission, that you would probably pay slightly more attention to what the commander says on the away mission.
I feel like if you're on a random planet and yous were just exploring it, yous wouldn't be by yourselves and yous would be in pairs.
Also, in the 24th century, have we not learnt horror movie rules? Don't separate in a dark place.
That's true. I don't do it in reality.
I suppose he's an alien, he can get away with it. He picks up a bio sign and then the wall disappears as he walks away, and a man comes out with a case and a weapon and ends up shooting Neelix, and the other two hear screams. What do they hear? We're coming to you now. They're rushing to
him. No, he freaks out because he sees this, he reports it immediately.
Yeah.
And then Tuvok's like, okay, we're coming now.
Yeah.
And they're all rushing, trying to get to him. And it's all too late because
they find Neelix on the floor, gasping, not even gasping, just trying to breathe, but not actually breathing. Like he's not going like that. He's going like he's got no lungs to breathe into, which I thought was quite cool actually.
Yeah, that was
like, good. Like it's a really like,
again, Neelix, best character.
If you haven't watched his ranking of characters, I suggest you do because he goes insane.
No, it's not insane. Think about it.
He got his lungs removed. Anyway, so Chakotay, Tuvok, Neelix beam up to Voyager. The doctor goes, oh, his lungs are completely removed.
They're surgically removed.
Surgically removed. And instantly, Kes is devastated. And Neelix, I believe they give him, they just give him air at the beginning, but they can't make...
Yeah, they oxygenate his blood.
Yes.
Which is the most technobabble thing in this entire series I've actually understood.
And I don't know why they're in the 24th century and that's not good enough.
Because it's not a long-term fix.
But surely they've got... Like, there's a million fixes for this. What they choose to do seems a bit odd. But I get where they're going.
Hey, well, it's Neelix. Number one, he's Talaxian. It's like their first time dealing with Talaxian lung issues.
Yeah, so
they don't really have many records of what a Talaxian lung looks like, I'm assuming.
So the lungs have been completely removed, like just taken out, beamed out surgically. And Janeway is obviously surprised and horrified, and
she's pissed off.
Yeah, and she wants to find out what's going on. So Chakotay and Tuvok go back, but not before I believe the doctor comes up with a way. Because Tom Paris is like, oh,
they're on the hunt. So they're on the hunt, and then he comes up with the idea because it clicks with him. Hey, I'm in a hollow fucking deck, basically.
Yeah. Holographic.
Oh lungs. My god.
Yeah.
Which is I'm not saying a dumb idea, it's a smart idea. But I don't get how, if the computer, say the doctor's walking around and he's holding an actual physical item, right? He's holding a tiny Squirtle. The hologram would have to keep up with him moving the Squirtle around.
Yeah, right? But that's there's a solution to that. They have it in the episode.
He doesn't hold the Squirtle. No, they hold him still.
Yeah, they hold him
still.
No,
I get that. They put him in essentially what is a... What are they called?
It's like... It's just basically...
An iron lung. They put him in essentially an iron lung situation where he is locked down. He cannot move. Unfortunately, it does mean that he can speak. But
what do you mean? It's Neelix. This is some of the best acting you get
so
out of
the lungs. So the lungs inside of him are holographic. And as I'm saying, if the lungs are just sort of taking an oxygen, that's like a steady motion, pretty much, right? There's a lot less of a risk than it controlling someone doing that or moving around with instruments or interacting. Like,
but it's got to be perfect. If it's not perfect, then he drowns.
He doesn't drown, he nothings.
Yeah, but exactly.
It's a good idea. I just go, really? It's just something that I was thinking, I'm going, no, that should be something they can do. What? But that was just me in the moment.
Yeah.
So Tuvok and Chakotay are on the planet. They find a research lab with different organs in it. It's like hearts, lungs.
Did Janeway go on this away mission?
Did she? I can't remember
either. So just a bit of a peek into it. We did intend to release this episode last week. We watched the episode. We didn't bother rewatching.
I mean, couldn't be bothered doing the review.
Yeah.
So we're doing this purely off mine and his memory, which is goldfish. But yeah, so they find all of these things, but they don't find Neelix's lungs. So they've got to basically hunt down these people, which they do. There's a ship fleeing, they chase after them, and Neelix is sort of grappling with being in the iron lung his whole life.
He hasn't been put in the iron lung just yet. Kes and the doctor have a very interesting conversation about consent of Kes. So Kes has to give the doctor consent to do this risky procedure to save Neelix's life.
Okay. And she does, and they put in an iron lung. Anyway.
Okay. You just didn't figure out.
No, I get the consent thing, but it's...
It's very important to Cass's character because it also introduces the idea of...
I get that she cares for Neelix. What I don't like is... There's a lot of strength in Cass's character. There's a lot of things around Cass that don't work for me, which is like... like Neelix being sort of sorry for himself and saying, I get that, but I don't feel like his emotion for the fact that he could be locked up like that forever.
But you're also forgetting how supportive Tom Paris was to Cass.
No, but that
he was super supportive. He wanted to save Neelix's life.
No, but that's what I'm bringing up. The fact that they go, oh, how can we show that he's scared? Oh, we'll just make him jealous of Tom. It's stupid. Like, to be fair, Tom is a little bit flirty with Kes in the show. It's obvious. But at the same time...
He's just hot.
I get that. But at the same time, I don't get why that's... Kes... anyway, there's a lot of issues around Neelix and Kes. Their age difference. The fact that there's no real romantic chemistry between the two actors. Like, they make okay friends who care about each other, but they don't really...
I feel like
really...
that's all they're meant to be. I feel like that's all that Neelix is after in life. It's just the companion.
No, Neelix wants to shag her. It's pretty clear that he's obsessed with her. I don't think Kes is, because Kes is too young to really know what love is. So it's a weird thing. But that jealousy, and it also seems like if you're like locked in an iron lung and your lungs have been removed, the last thing you're going to worry about is someone stealing your girl. You're going to be like, I'm going to die.
But can you also imagine, okay, you've just woken up from a coma. There's a really hot guy right next to me, and he's consoling me about it. What would you think? What would you think?
I wouldn't think about that. I'd be thinking, oh my God, I'm awake from a coma. That's what I feel like.
Okay. That's what you want to go with? Okay.
As with
I'll be annoyed.
The difference is to have a secure relationship is to just, you just have to trust that other person. That's a secure relationship. Secure relationship style. I've done a bit of therapy. But yeah, like a secure relationship style is I can't control you as a person. So if you're going to cheat, you're going to cheat. If you're going to do things, it's going to happen. I just have to trust that you care about me and that won't happen.
Well, I care about you too.
But what I mean is you can't, this is just a weird, like, this old alien is really weirdly obsessed with this young alien thing. And she's clearly hotter than him in every possible way. And that's what I find. I just find their relationship, it's toxic. It's horrible. And they do sort of deal with that later on, like the jealousy and stuff like that. But it's just from the get-go, just does not work.
Well, this is the thing. Like, I don't think they've been in a relationship very long at that point. I don't think they're really in a relationship.
Enough that, like, Neelix basically tricked Voyager into going back to the Compton homeworld to save it.
Yeah, but I feel like that's just because Neelix was an obsessed slob.
Yeah,
he was just
I love you person. After the first date kind
of. Yeah, like I just met you.
So
oh shit.
So they're chasing a ship. It fires at them. I don't think it's particularly strong, but they
No, it doesn't fire at them at all. They're just chasing.
It's just trying to run away.
They go into another asteroid.
Oh yeah, the weird Hall of Mirrors asteroid.
And it's actually kind of cool.
Yeah, no, I forgot that. So they go into this asteroid and it's a Hall of Mirrors. A, really difficult to make logistically. That's a lot of glass. B, if it's not glass, it's something else. I did like the way their solution was.
A very low beam laser.
Yeah, just like fire the phasers, low beam, they'll ricochet off everything and hit the real ship eventually. Like,
it's a solution.
It is, but it's a bit like, I don't know how to put it. It's a bit like a Scooby-Doo solution.
This is a total Scooby-Doo episode.
It's very, that whole reason is very Scooby-Doo.
It's some sort of invisible force field.
It's called glass, Fred.
An invisible force field made out of glass. Genius.
Yeah.
Then they beam the two aboard. And what did you think of the race
gross.
Of the Vidians? I think it could have been grosser.
I feel like I anticipated your question before.
No, genuinely, I remember when I first saw them, and now I think they should have gone worse, because they should have. Yeah. But I remember thinking, oh, they're really ugly, they're horrible. And then when they explained what they are, which is a race of people who've been living with a degenerative disease for centuries, and they just steal organs and parts from other species in order to keep themselves going, there is a level of sympathy for them.
I don't know. I think this is a point where you do that and then it just becomes your bit of a horror thing that just is just eating everyone.
I think it's a really good judge of Janeway's character. I think a good judge of whether they're going to go the rules or not. Because you think they've almost killed an officer, you're going to kill them by taking the lungs out. Because one of the Vidians has Neelix's lungs inside his body. Using them, they've been genetically modified in his things, and they talk about how their race is ancient and they have to fight this constantly. They have like a nurse ward thing, so there's like one guy who looks after another guy, but who looks after the first guy? I don't know.
I think they can look after each other.
Yeah, so
I think that's the whole point.
I really like, and their surgical instrument, which is this cool, like, I want to say,
it's a tricorder,
pointy tricorder phaser medical instrument, was kind of cool, and I love the way they used it. But basically, it comes down to, will Janeway kill this Vidian in order to save Neelix? Now, the answer should always be, no, don't kill the Vidian, because Neelix is annoying. you know, since you've said you like Neelix, I'm actively going to talk down about Neelix.
But he's great. Think about anyway. It.
So, Janeway is just like, I can't sacrifice you, but I need you guys to know that it's not going to happen. And they, basically, they accept the fact that she's accepting the fact that Neelix is probably going to be that way forever, if not die.
Yeah.
And she accepts that she's lost, but she hasn't lost her humanity to empathize with these aliens.
I can't begin to understand what your people have gone through. They may have found a way to ignore the moral implications of what you're doing, but I have no such luxury. I don't have the freedom to kill you to save another. My culture finds that to be a reprehensible and entirely unacceptable act. If we were closer to home, I would lock you up and turn you over to my authorities for trial. But I don't even have that ability here. And I am not prepared to carry you forever in our brig. So I see no other alternative. But to let you go.
A very modern, very TNG era Trek thing to do. Like Picard, I imagine, would have done the same thing. Sisko probably would have killed everyone.
He would have just taken lungs.
He would have just been like, they're my fucking lungs. No.
Fuck you.
But so the Vidians clearly have better medical technology than the Federation. And they basically offer to transplant someone else's lungs into Neelix's, and Kes offers, but they do a test and they scan everyone. They can pretty much transfer anything. There's a nice little moment where they scan the doctor and he doesn't exist.
Yeah.
I think the doctor's good in this episode as well.
Well, they don't reveal that in the hologram at all.
No, they don't tell anyone.
Yeah, they don't tell the Benians that he's a hologram, because they still seen them as hostile.
Yeah. It's I don't know. It's a weird thing, because I think these bad guys, the Vidians, are a much stronger, I don't even say they're bad guys, a much stronger antagonist to Voyager than the fucking Kazon.
Well, how about the Ferengi?
The Ferengi haven't been in it yet.
Yeah, no, they haven't been in the Voyager, but they've been in the Next Gen.
Yeah,
and well, how great are they as a replacement to the Klingons?
Yeah,
right?
Yeah, it was the same sort of thing, except they replaced the Klingons with a slightly more dirty, funny-looking Klingon. Like, it wasn't like the Klingons and the Ferengi don't look anything alike, but the fucking Klingons and the Kazon look exactly the same.
Yeah.
Essentially. But overall, Neelix survives, Kes gives him his lungs, she only has one. There's a lot of love and a lot of care, and they're all happy, and Janeway does offer a threat, like, you come near us again, we will fucking take you.
We will kill you.
But at this instance, they let them go on their way, and then everything's okay. Neelix is offering to be back in the kitchen cooking whatever meals he cooks. Oh, and Kes gets asked to help in the sick bay with the doctor.
She becomes a trainee nurse.
Yeah, and I think their pairing's really good, because the two characters who surprisingly do have chemistry are Kes and the doctor.
Yeah, and that's what I was going to sort of mention a bit earlier about how there's that moment where they're having that conversation about Neelix's life, basically, whether or not they're going to put this hologram lung in him.
Mm.
And it's like this back and forth.
I feel like,
and it's a really nice scene. Like, there's a lot of really nice scenes between the doctor and Kes.
I feel like Neelix should have been in more shock and fear. Like he is, but it just feels like that would be a fucking horrible situation. Well,
the most that he's annoyed about is that the roof is really boring.
Yeah, which I liked. And I liked the fact that Kes came in and did it up with some tapestry.
Well, that's what he asked for.
No, but I think.
Like, If I was in hospital and I turned around and said, I want this thing, you'd just get it, wouldn't you?
That was the other thing as well. In the 24th century, and you're in a holodeck sick bay, right? They literally could have projected an entire fucking alien world around Neelix, or an alien vista, or something to keep him entertained. Like, the guy's locked down, distracted.
I feel like that's a budget issue, though. More than anything else, I feel like that would have been a budget issue.
It's your first season of a show. You want to impress.
Yeah.
Like, if you had that back, even just that back of
sick bay. Yeah, but do you remember the last episode before this one? And how the aliens were literally just... They were just humans.
Were they just crinkly foreheads?
No, they were just
humans. But yeah, I get like, that.
There's something going on about this first season where they are literally on a shoestring budget.
I think with the first season of Voyager, they were like, oh, TNG works, so we can just do it that way. I don't think there was any...
I think that's also because they were spending a lot of money at the time on DS9.
No.
They would have already spent a shit ton of money on DS9. Think about those sets.
The sets were the same. They used like five sets.
Yeah, but the first season of DS9 would have been very expensive.
Yeah, the first season, which aired in the second to last season of TNG before Voyager is even thought of.
Yeah, but maybe they were trying to be like preempted not being liked, like the way DS9 wasn't liked at the time.
What are you talking about?
DS9 wasn't liked at the time.
Yes, it wasn't liked at the time. You learned from the documentary that he couldn't finish because it was 2 hours long.
You decided not to watch it. He gave up. He was like, let's do this. I want apple pie was his exact words. I've seen it
before. We also have apple pie. So that'll be delicious later. I don't think it was a budgetary thing. Star Trek was always expensive. I think it's we can get away with being a bit cheap.
Yeah.
I think it was like, just like, oh, we could just do this. It's fine.
Yeah, and it was like, oh, we've already got a winning formula. Yeah. Don't worry about it.
I feel like
this is exactly what the fans want.
I think that was the difference between Voyager and Deep Space Nine overall. Is Deep Space Nine felt like they were always struggling to do what they wanted to do, and Voyager always felt like they were always just kind of going through the motions. And I think that was a lot of my issues.
That's the point of Voyager. Voyager was literally just meant to be TNG. Actually, like, it's just meant to be TNG.
It's just meant to be the original series.
Here's a ship flying around exploring the universe. That's all it's meant to be fucking being.
Yeah, but the problem is the exploration in Voyager is different from TOS and TNG in that they'll have something they're exploring, but they'll do some drama with the characters. And it's something that happens in newer Trek a lot as well. I'd say it's a bit of a mix in newer Trek, but in Voyager, it went from being about a phenomena and the end of TNG and some of DS9, it went to being about the characters with that phenomena.
Yeah.
Which is fine. It's just a different way of doing a show. I liked this episode. I think the Vidians are good bad guys. I think Kate Mulgrew gave some damn good speech work. I think the Doctor worked really well. I think Kes and the Doctor really worked. I think Tom really needs to stop flirting randomly with.
Talking about the Doctor, and he has his own speech about ethics of being a Doctor as well. And there's a lot of ethics in this entire episode.
Yeah, and the thing is, it's lots of big stuff thrown at you in this episode. And you're sort of going, the Vidians are a really interesting group of people. That whole, and even the struggle it puts Janeway through in her head, like, it makes a lot of sense. Janeway always chooses to save the aliens.
Yeah.
And not save her crewmen. To be fair, though, with Neelix.
What do you mean? It's Neelix.
Anyways,
whiskers, doesn't he?
What does that have to do with anything?
Catman.
Anyway, I like cats, not Neelix. He's more of a dog man. Yum. What did you think of this episode? I really enjoyed it. I'm presuming you loved it because Neelix was involved. Make sure to like, comment, and subscribe, and come back for Star Trek Enterprise reviews, other videos I do randomly. There's at least 2 or 3 videos a week. Oh, my new Villains of Star Trek series next week is Gorn. Yeah, I'm doing it by myself.
Oh my God. Oh my God.
Content by myself. It's much easier. Anyways, thank you for watching. Say goodbye, Ribbit.
Bye bye.
Why'd you gay it up for?
Because I'm gay.
Very gay.
Super gay. But you're gay, are you? Hey, come here. Give me a kiss.
Get your homosexual lips away from you.